These are a little big. I might next time get some smaller ones. See, that one's really light. Like I said, I really need to put some of these in bigger pots.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Yet to come, greater things are still to be done here. You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done.
With them. Yes, power. I am now. And if you weren't awake, you are now, right? We're so delighted that you have gathered with us this morning for worship. Brother Jamie, just to let you know, is enjoying a much and deserved and long-awaited vacation on the beach. They don't be practicing deadly sin of envy that we talked about last week. But he's with his family, and we rejoice that he has the opportunity to have a few days away with his family. So we're grateful that you are here this morning. We will continue in our sermon series, The Game. And today we will have the opportunity to look at anger versus forgiveness. But until we reach that time, we are delighted that you're here. Let us join our hearts and our minds together in praising God this morning. Will you pray with me? Holy and amazing God, we give you thanks for this day. Lord, we give you thanks for this day where we stop and we pause and we remember our relationship with you. We remember our love for you and our adoration of you. And we remember that you are the God who created us, that knows the number of hairs on our heads and is constantly, constantly working for good in our world. Lord, meet us here in this place as we celebrate the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Let our prayers, our words, our thoughts, and our songs be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. It's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care. Glad to see so many here this morning. We were kind of worried that not too many would show up, but you're here and we're grateful. I want to welcome people who might be guests with us this morning. We're so glad that you're going to worship with us. And if you happen to be a guest here for the first time, we have a gift we'd like to share with you, and we need you to help us make that happen. Before you leave here this morning, there's a desk at the back of the room. If you will go there and just give us your name and address. When we have that, later this week, someone will stop by your home. They will drop off an insulated mug that is yours to keep. But that mug is going to have information in it that tells about the many ministries and the many ways that we have in this church to serve our Lord, to serve people in our community and beyond, and to serve one another. So I hope that sounds good to you. In the meantime, we ask that everyone enjoy the fellowship that is in this place this morning. We do have attendance pads, and they start off in the middle aisle chairs on either side and on the tables. Please sign your name to that attendance pad. Pass it down. Let's get everybody to sign that, because your signature lets us know you are here, but it also helps us to figure out who might not have been able to be here this morning. And with that kind of information, we can do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So we appreciate you helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, I've got just a couple that I'd like to touch on, and the first one is the bazaar. We've been talking about the bazaar all year. The United Methodist Women have been busily all year long making things for the bazaar, and so that's coming up in less than a month on October 3rd, which is a Saturday. So they are ready now for people that have been making things at home to start bringing them in so they can be priced and get ready for the bazaar. There's a lot of information on the bulletin for the UMW bulletin board at the back of the room. There's a place there where you can sign up to volunteer to help on that day with things that are yet to be, that still need to be done. And there's a whole lot more information that you can read about the bazaar and what those needs are if you'll check out this month's newsletter. So you've got all that bazaar information. Discipline and Discovery, it's a new spiritual growth class that's being led by Reverend Albert Fisher, and it starts on Tuesday this week. So we hope that it's at 4:00. So those of you that want to participate in that, sign up in the office or just come at 4:00 this coming Tuesday. And when mourning dawns, a journey through grief, we've got a number of people that are participating in that. This is just a reminder that they are not going to be meeting this Monday because of the holiday, but they'll be back on the regular schedule a week from this Monday. And last, I want to talk to you about United Methodist Men. The Methodist Men are having their regular monthly meeting this Wednesday night at 6:30 here in Becker Hall. For some reason, the prayer notification or the notification did not go out electronically. So what we're asking all of the men, if you are a man and you are here and you would like to go to that dinner this Wednesday night, please, in the attendance pad, grab any kind of piece of paper out of there, put your name on it, and put UMM, and get it in the offering plate, and we're going to add those up so that we know how many meals to order for this Wednesday night's dinner. So thank you, men, for helping us with that. With that, that's all I have. God bless, and thank you.
Good morning, everyone. If you're able, please stand and sing our first song with us this morning.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Now I surrender. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shining light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. You are mighty, You're mighty to save.
Our God is mighty to save, and there is nothing that is beyond our God's power to do. God is good,
all the time.
And all the time. Let us share God's love and hope with one another as we exchange signs of reconciliation and peace. Greet your neighbor in love.
Do we have all the children, young at heart and young in body? Any more children to come up? Okay, well, we're going to go ahead and start with the children's message. Hi, everybody. We're glad you're here today. You're so brave to come up here in front of everybody, huh? Is it kind of scary to come up here in front of everybody? No. Well, good for you. I'm glad that that's true. Well, we're going to talk a little bit about what you're going to talk about in Sunday school this morning, and I forgot something, so let me get up. You're going to start a brand new lesson. Yay! Something new down in Sunday school. And what you're going to start about is talking about is God's creation. And today, especially, you're going to talk about how God created our earth and all the things that are in it. But today, you're especially going to talk about the earth. What are some of the things that, oh, here comes the little one. That's Everly. Everly, she's just a baby. How God created the air that we breathe. Everybody take a breath. God created that air. Is that not cool? And God created the earth. There's earth down underneath this building that we stand on. And that's pretty cool. And God created the lakes. We have a lot of lakes here in Bella Vista. And God created the sun that came up this morning. And the moon that went down and the stars. Did any of you see the stars last night? They're beautiful. Yes, they're beautiful. So that's what you're going to talk about today. And we're going to talk about how all of that is good. Very good. And one thing, the reason I went back to get this was one thing I wanted to show you is you're going to talk about where that is in the Bible. And I do have mine upside down. No. We're glad you came up to be with us. Thank you for doing that. Where that's found about how God created the sun and the moon and the stars and the water and the earth and the air is in Genesis at the very beginning of your Bible. And that the name of Genesis, that means beginning. That's what that means. And so you'll look at that when you go downstairs to Sunday school. How many of you have gone on a trip this summer? Did any of you go on a trip? Did you go someplace special? What was special? What was good about where you went? Tell me something about it. Did you go swimming or hiking or, yeah? Went to Washington and what island? Orcas Island. And what is it, Orcas Island? Do you know? Do you remember? I don't mean to ask hard questions. I've never been there. I was just hoping you might. Are there whales there? No? No. Yeah? No. I don't know. It's all whales. Okay. Cool. So that was Earth that you'd never seen before, huh? Washington and Orcas Island. And that island is surrounded by water, right? All right. Good. Who else wants to share where you've been? Yeah.
I went to Chuck E. Cheese.
You went to Chuck E. Cheese. Oh, that's so fun. Well, I guess I can't exactly say God created Chuck E. Cheese, but God created it through the folks who created it. So, and that was good stuff to eat and fun things to play, and all that was good, wasn't it? Yeah. Well, I wanted to show you a picture just because. Can you see what this is a picture of?
A beach.
A beach. Yeah, you see that? Anybody see it? You see that, Zoe? You see that, Everly? Yeah. That beach, it's a beach, and there's a lot of blue sky up above it, and there's sand dunes and sand and the ocean, or maybe it's the Gulf, but there's water. That is a picture that Brother Jamie posted while he's on vacation at the beach. And how I thought, when I looked at that, I thought about all the things that God created there that are good and have allowed him to have fun with his family, the air and the sea and the sand and the dunes and the all the other things that are there. So that's just a picture of some of the things that God has created on the earth that are good and we enjoy. Well, before you go to Sunday school, let's pray. Can we pray together? Okay. Dear God, thank you for creating the air we breathe and the land we stand on and the water we swim in. Thank you for your creations. It is all good. Amen. All right, go ahead and follow the orange line.
I don't know.
That was harder than you thought.
Once again, if you're able, please stand and sing with us this morning.
Your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with a sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough. Great is your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy
forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh,
you to be seated. We have come to the time in our worship where we lift up the joys and concerns of our church family to our Lord. We have a lot of joys. Some of you may know Norma McLean. She is a resident of Highlands, and this week it will be her 93rd birthday. She, 93, that's amazing, isn't it? She's a, if you haven't met her, she is a real upbeat little lady. And I was talking to her sister before the early service, and she said that it's come to a point where the staff there, she moved from one room to another, they kind of fight over her because she's such a joy to be around. They want to be there. So it's like, well, can she be on my hall? No, I want her over on my hall. So 93 years old and still a joy. So please lift her up in prayer. We had the whole Bacon family and first service, a whole pew, a family in celebration of Karen's 70th. She said it was okay to tell you. 70th birthday. That is certainly a joy. A gift will be given to the sound system in honor of Frank and Marilyn Costell's 54th wedding anniversary. So that is certainly a joy as well. We had Roger and Allison Totten join our church family in the early service, and that is a joy as well. And we have folks back from Sega Brown. Welcome home. We're glad everyone made it back safely, and I know it was an awesome experience while y'all, Janet is up here, but I know there are others in the back as well who were there. And the ability to take a break and get away, and some of you are visiting here, and others like Brother Jamie have gone somewhere else to visit, just to break up the routine, catch your breath, breathe that fresh air that God has made for us to breathe and enjoy. All of those are among our joys this week. We do have concerns. This past week, Sybil Martin, who had been at the Arms at Concordia and most recently at Innisfree and Rogers, passed away. We had her service yesterday in the sanctuary here. A big family was here in celebration of her life. And so lift up that family as they mourn her passing. The other carnation is for Emma Rose Jennings, who passed away a week ago yesterday. And her service will be in Wichita at a future date. There are several folks who have been in the hospital but have gone home. Ralph Johnson had eye surgery and is at home. Shirley Davenport was in the hospital for tests and is now home. And Julie Booker had cancer surgery and she is now home. So keep all of those in your prayers. Unfortunately, we do have some who are in the hospital still. Emery Antoine. You may know the Antoines, Ashley and Dylan, who worship in this service. Emery is down in Arkansas Children's Hospital. She has had some malignant tumors removed from her abdomen, and she is still down there, will remain there for a while for continued diagnosis and treatment. So please lift Emery, who's only two, in your prayers. Vicki Hoy is in, she worships in this service. She is in ICU in Washington Regional. She has had a stroke, so please lift her in prayer and her daughter, who's downstairs taking care of the little ones as well. Dale Veach, Nancy is here and probably in the back. And Nancy, I can't see you, but I know Dale is in, there you are. Dale is in our prayers. He is in Northwest Bentonville, been having some kidney issues, I believe. Okay, and please lift Dale and Nancy in prayer as well. And Bob Shaw, Bob and Jan are both in Omaha at the moment. Bob will have kidney surgery at the medical center there on Wednesday, so lift those in prayers as well. So a lot of folks who are struggling with illness, hospitalization, recovering from surgery, please keep them all in your prayers. And know that there will be a complete list of all of this and others for you to pick up to take home to keep in your prayers during the week. I also want to lift the church this week especially. We always pray for churches here in Bella Vista, but this week our church to pray for is Bella Vista Community Church. They have been struggling recently, and we have had a number of their folks who have worshiped with us. We have been a harbor in the storm for them. Some folks have chosen to join our community of faith. Others have now returned to Community Church to begin the healing. So please pray for healing to come to that church, that they may become a strong family again. As we prepare to join our hearts and our minds and our souls in prayer, may we also join our hearts in giving. At the end of the prayer, an offering will be taken. We ask that you reflect on all the blessings that you have been given, the blessings of creation, the blessings of forgiveness, and that you offer back, whether it's $1 or many, your gift in praise and worship to a God who loved us first. Please bow with me. Holy and gracious God, we come to you this day with the challenges of this world rolling all around us. Many of us have loved ones who have been facing surgery and illness and all kinds of struggles just happen on a daily basis here on this earth. We get pulled in so many different directions. And many times we do not stop to listen for your voice. And yet you send your Holy Spirit to be present in our lives, to show us your truth and your light. Lord, forgive us when we turn away and don't take a moment to seek your presence. But instead, with all the frustration and the chaos, we grow angry and we lash out at others and at ourselves, and we can't seem to see that that only makes things worse. Help us to listen to your voice. Help us to hear and heed your voice. Jesus, you came to walk with us in the flesh. You left the comfort of heaven while we were still sinners to walk among us. You came to show us forgiveness. You came to grant us forgiveness, to reconcile us to you and to each other. Help us, Lord, to know that forgiveness. Help us to be slow to speak and quick to forgive as you have forgiven us. We give you thanks for the many, many joys that we are experiencing this week, birthdays and anniversaries and visits with family and friends and trips and the beach and the air we breathe. So many joys, so many blessings you give to us each day. We ask for your healing touch to be upon all those who have faced illness, are facing illness and surgery. So many struggles, Lord, and we need you to help us through. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you give us and for the healing in our lives. And we ask that you instill in us a new, clean heart that seeks you in all things. We pray that you will send your Holy Spirit to rest upon Pastor Judy as she delivers this message that you have placed on her heart this week. Lord, help each of us to hear the words that are meant for just us in this message, for each one of us is intended for some of those words. They come from you. Lord, we lift up these prayers and all the unspoken prayers of our hearts to you this day as we join together in the prayer which Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Answers.
Travel this earth-shifting sands that transcend all the reason of man. But the things that matter the most in this world, they can never be held in our hand. I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I believe whatever the cost, and when time Christ who was slain on the cross has the power to save lives today. For he changed me completely, a new life is mine. That is why by the cross I will stay. And I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I believe whatever the cost, and with time I surrender. To cling to that old rugged cross.
Well, this morning we continue in our sermon series, The Game, which looks at Team Deadly Sins and Team Heavenly Virtues. And so just as a reminder, as though you actually need one, we've covered pride versus humility, greed versus generosity, and envy versus kindness. And so today we get to look at anger versus forgiveness. Now, I don't know about you, but has anybody in here noticed that since we began these sermon series, you've become more aware of these deadly sins in your life and the opportunity to look at them and perhaps do something different to change those things in your life? Am I the only one that's noticed that? Good. I would hate to think I was all by myself. Misery loves company, you know. But you know, when I heard Brother Jamie speaking a couple of weeks ago, I was struck as he was talking about the coaches for each team, the coach for deadly sins, trying to manipulate and control and maneuver us into committing the deadly sins, and the coach for the heavenly virtues, also trying to guide us into a more godly life. I was reminded of a book by C.S. Lewis. I don't know how many of you all are familiar with C.S. Lewis, but he was a great scholar. He was a professor of English literature. He taught first at Oxford, and then he went to Cambridge. And for much of his life, C.S. Lewis was an atheist. But then he had a conversion experience. And when he had that conversion experience, he became a Christian. And he wrote prolifically. And there are many Christian books by him, some having to do with theology, others having to do with fiction, that talk about Christian topics and issues. The book that in particular that came to mind was his book, The Screwtape Letters. But other books that he has written are Mere Christianity, and also the ones that you would probably be most familiar with that have now been made into a series of movies are The Chronicles of Narnia. But as I heard Brother Jamie speaking and preaching that day, I thought about The Screwtape Letters, which are a fiction, and they're written from the perspective of the coach for the deadly sins team. And he is trying to manipulate and control his human subject into committing the deadly sins, all of them, at various times. And it's interesting to see how he uses human nature to commit and entice humans, his human subject, to commit the deadly sins. Now, of course, when we're talking about the deadly sins, anger is one of them. But Lewis presents a little bit different understanding of anger, something that kind of took me by surprise, and I had to look at the opportunities during the week when I would get angry to see if this perhaps fit. And unfortunately, I found that it did. What he said was that it's not the events or the mistakes or the hardships in our life that cause the anger. It's the attitude and the perceptions that we take through life that cause the reaction of anger. Now, that's a little bit hard to grasp, so let me give you a couple of examples. One of the things that came to mind was competition, whether it be a golf game with your buddies, or perhaps it's a football game like yesterday when the Razorbacks played the University of Texas at San Antonio. But that competition, and you know, let's face it, let's be honest about it, we size up our opponents, right? I mean, we all knew that we should win, the Razorbacks should win yesterday because they were playing a preseason game, right? Yeah, that's right. They should. And we do the same thing with our golf games and perhaps even with cards and other various types of competition, maybe even when we've studied for a test and we're preparing for school, that we anticipate that we will do well. So it's not the failure so much as the disappointment of not having our expectations met that can lead us to anger. Another example might be the use of our time. I don't know about you guys, but I look forward to things like a special dinner with my husband, or perhaps a much and long-deserved vacation like Brother Jamie is on today. And I anticipate and I expect the time that I'm going to have on those events. And so when something happens, perhaps a phone call that interrupts that, or even an illness that causes me not to enjoy something that I've looked forward to and anticipated, that I expect, and I really honestly feel like I deserve, then the response can be anger. So you see, what happens is the coach of the deadly sins team is trying to convince us that we have an entitlement, a right to things a certain way, that we have ownership of our lives and the outcomes of events. Now, the truth is that that's an illusion, and the coach knows that. But if the coach can convince us that it is in fact that way, then the result can be anger. If we look at our scripture passages for today, we had a scripture passage earlier from James, and we have one from the Proverbs this morning. And I want to read you the passage from James. My dear brothers and sisters, it's from James 1, 19 through 21, for those who have their Bibles. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. I wonder if we began to look at our lives as gifts, if we would be as quick to get angry when things don't, would we be as quick to respond with an angry word or lashing out if our expectations weren't met, if we didn't have the things that we felt like we were entitled to. You see, our lives are pure gifts. As Brenda pointed out, the breath, the air that we breathe is a gift. Our families, our homes, our church is a gift from God. The Proverbs today, I want you to listen to them as I read them, because I found as I meditated on them throughout the week that the examples that are given in these Proverbs, these words that are given to us for a godly way of living, are great examples of people who have succumbed to anger because they didn't get what they wanted. And worse yet, they spread that anger and that venom to others. This is from Proverbs 29, verses 6 through 11. Evildoers are snared by their own sin, but the righteous shout for joy and are glad. The righteous care about justice for the poor, but the wicked have no such concern. Mockers stir up a city, but the wise turn away anger. If a person goes to court with a fool, the fool rages and scoffs, and there is no peace. The bloodthirsty hate a person of integrity and seek to kill the upright. Fools give vent to their rage, but the wise bring calm to the end. Can't you just imagine those mockers, those ones who go out into the world and they spread lies, and they are angry because things haven't gone their way, and so they go and they spread these lies and they make other people angry as well. Who in here has heard these words? I may get angry, but I get right over it. Who said that? I've said it a time or two. But you know, the thing about it is, when we do that, when that explosion happens, then the damage is done. The shrapnel has flown, and it's caused the harm. You know, the thing about anger, too, is if we don't work through it and get past it, then it gets inside of us, and it acts like an infection. It festers within us. And it can almost be like taking poison ourselves, expecting the other person to die. You know, when we begin to practice gratitude for our lives, and we don't take things for granted, and we don't expect that we are entitled to a particular outcome, and that we don't control the way things turn out, we can be slower to anger. But you may be asking me, Judy, that's all great and good, but what happens when we do, when we are injured? What happens when we have been harmed and we need to get past that? The coach for Team Heavenly Virtues would say that we need to forgive. I don't know about you, but depending on the offense, forgiveness can be a pretty difficult pill to swallow. It can be tough. It can be challenging. I always think of Peter. I just love Peter. You know, Peter was one of those guys, he just said whatever came in his mind. You know, he was up on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus, and he says, he doesn't know what to say, so he says, can we build a tent for you guys? You know, when the topic of forgiveness came up, he said to Jesus, he said, so, how many times do I have to forgive? Seven. And Jesus said, no, you need to forgive 70 times seven. And can't you see Peter standing there going, 490 times? That's how many times you want me to forgive? His whole point was to forgive until we no longer remember that we need to forgive. So how do we do it? How do we forgive when we've been wronged? I'm one of those real practical people. I need some real tangible tools on how to do this. There's a couple of thoughts on this. You know, the golden rule says to treat other people as we want to be treated. So the person that we need and want to forgive, perhaps we can treat them as we would want to be treated. If they're sick, we can provide a meal. If they're lonely, we can make a phone call or send a card. We can act as if we are forgiving them until the forgiveness happens. Another way to forgive is to pray for our enemy. You know, it's one thing to pray for those that we love and we're close to. It's a whole other thing to pray for our enemies. But that's what Jesus tells us to do, is to pray for those who have harmed us. I want to share with you a particular experience where I had the opportunity to use both of these tools in my life. When I was a practicing attorney, I had a coworker who had agreed to take a phone conference for me with a judge. And so I was on another phone conference, assuming that he was doing what he said he was going to do, and he got a phone call from one of his friends, and he failed to take that conference. So as you can imagine, I suffered the wrath of the judge and the other parties in the phone conference that he had failed to take for me. I thought about it a couple of days, and I thought, you know, I need to go say something to him, but I want to be calm. So I took a couple of days, and I went to him, and I told him how I felt, and that I was disappointed, and that I felt like I couldn't trust him anymore, and I was met with cursing. And he cursed me until I left the room. Well, I had every right to be angry, don't y'all think? I mean, it would have been a righteous anger. I was completely entitled to be angry at him. But you know, God would not leave me there. And I was prompted to start praying for him. Not once a day, but twice a day, in the morning and in the evening. And I have to be honest with you, my prayers at first were, bless him. There wasn't any sincerity in them. But you know, over time, as I continued, my prayers became more sincere. And as we interacted, he continued to act as if I wasn't even in the room. There would be a group of us, and he would walk in, and he would speak to everybody except me. But I continued to pray. And at the end of about 20 or 30 days, as I was continuing to pray, I got the sense from the Holy Spirit that even that wasn't enough. And I got this prompting that I needed to speak to him. I needed to treat him like I wanted to be treated. And I have to admit, at that point, I said, are you kidding me, God? Am I not doing enough already? But I did, and I began speaking to him. Because you see, what I've learned is that forgiveness is much about the person who has been wronged as it is about the person who has wronged us. I won't tell you that our relationship ever was jolly-go-lucky again, but I can tell you this. I prayed for him and I did those things until I no longer remembered that I had to forgive him. So this week, I invite you, look for those areas in your life, those opportunities where you feel that little bit of anxiety and a little bit of bitterness or anger pop up in your life, and see where you are possibly being invited to forgive your brother or your sister. They'll be there. Pray with me. Holy and awesome God, you are constantly calling us to grow as your disciples, as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. And Lord, you know it's hard. It is hard. We become weary, and sometimes we think we can't do it. But your grace is always, always sufficient. So God, I pray for your strength. I pray for your wisdom, Lord, that we may recognize those areas where you are calling us to change, and that we may listen to the coach of the heavenly virtues so that we may walk in your love and the godly paths that your Son, Jesus Christ, showed us. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. This morning we have the honor and the privilege to come to the table of grace and forgiveness that has been given to us. We come with repentant hearts, seeking forgiveness for the ways in which we have strayed from God's path for our lives. So I invite you now to turn in your bulletin, if you have one, or they may be on the screen, the prayer of confession as we prepare to come to the table. If you will pray with me. Almighty God, you who shaped out of nothing all that is, forgive us for returning empty-handed. You who called forth light, forgive our preference for the dark. You who sent John to be a voice crying, forgive our unwillingness to say anything at all. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. This morning I join you long distance. I'm on a trip with my parents. It's just my parents and myself. The first time in my adult life that I've had the privilege of going on a trip with them, and we're in South Alabama. But I also gather with you as we celebrate Holy Communion, remembering what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has done for us as he prepared his disciples that one day he would go away. And you remember, as I do, that he gathered with his disciples at a table in an upper room. And in the holiness of that moment, he took bread, and he broke the bread, and he gave that to them and invited them to take and partake of the bread and do so in remembrance of him. And also on that holy night, he took a cup that was before him. He presented it to the disciples. He invited them to drink of the cup and to drink in remembrance of him. For he is the new covenant that makes us one. He is the new covenant that offers us life. He's the new covenant that offers to us salvation, redemption, and forgiveness of sins. And so together, as we gather in Holy Communion on this beautiful morning, made beautiful because of the presence of the Lord, we invite God through his Holy Spirit to bless the bread and to bless the cup. And may they be for us the body and blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. And may he make us one into a ministry unto all the world, so that we can go out into a world that is our home, a world that is our environment, our world that is our work life, our world that is our school life, whatever our world is, and bear the good news of the love of Jesus Christ. So as God blesses the cup, and as God blesses the bread, God blesses us with the powerful presence of his Son, and you're invited to partake and come to the table.
So this morning we will come and feast at God's table. This is not a United Methodist table, this is the Lord's table, so all are welcome and invited. We will partake of communion this morning through intinction, which means you will be given a piece of bread and you dip that into the cup before taking. The table is set. Will our ushers come, our folks that are helping come forward, and all are going to be welcome. The table is set. Come and feast.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created, all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began.
So this morning, we give thanks for the holy mystery found in this feast. We give thanks for the opportunity to gather as one body to partake of this feast. If this morning you feel led to come forward in need of prayer, then come forward and you can pray with one of the pastors or by yourself. If you feel led to become a part of this church body, we invite you to come forward during the singing of our last song.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised me, His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever.
It is an honor and a privilege this morning to welcome a new member into our family of faith. This is Jeff Canada. He is transferring his membership from First United Methodist Church in Rogers. And so, Jeff, I ask you, will you be faithful to the Bella Vista United Methodist Church and support it with through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? We welcome you as our newest member of our church. And so I would ask you all to take the opportunity to welcome Jeff after the service concludes. And so go this week into the world playing on team heavenly virtues. And remember that you're not called to just come to church, but you are called to
be the church.
Amen. Blessings on your journey this week. Thank you.